It's now my honor to introduce our governor, a man who has worked so hard to create jobs, and every week there's at least one or two new announcements about new jobs coming to Georgia, or jobs that people already have here, have a presence here, adding more jobs. Our governor, Nathan Deal.
Thank you very much, Brian. John Padgett and I both have a lot of catching up to do. I'm not going to let him just get himself off the hook. Please recognize the most active and, I believe, the best First Lady the state of Georgia has had, my wife, Sandra. Yeah. Asking people to vote for me. So would you please vote for me in November? I know you're standing and I know it's warm. I'll be brief. Gary is right, we have the best ideas. But let me tell you, not only do we have the best ideas, we have the best implementation of those ideas.
Right.
Sometimes the game of politics is who can have the catchiest slogan, who can have the little thing that you can resonate because it sounds lyrical, but it has no substance to it. My philosophy from the beginning was very simple. Jobs are the foundation stone upon which we build our economy, which we get ourselves through this great recession, and if we do that, we will recognize the goal that I set before the General Assembly in one of my State of the State addresses, and that was the goal to make Georgia the number one state in the nation in which to do business. We have implemented that. We got the first designation back last fall. Our opponents couldn't stand that. They tried to discredit the source of that rating. And then this year, CNBC said, they're right. Georgia is the best state in the nation in which to do business. I haven't heard a good rebuttal on the other side for that one. But let me tell you why that's important. It's a mantra that I have, and I hope you agree with me. If a person has a good job, they can provide for themselves, they can provide for their family, they can be charitable in their community, and they have less reason to ask government to do things for them. That is a conservative Republican mantra. It is one that we have put into practice. We didn't just get to be number one by saying we were going to be number one. We did some really hard work, and I want to thank the members of the General Assembly who are in the audience here today for their help. We have done remarkable things. In fact, our ideas have been so good that the other side had to vote with us on almost all of them. And I do believe that if you have good ideas and you're willing to implement them, it is very difficult, no matter what your political label might be, to stand up in opposition to them. It is the fact that we confronted our tax code. We said, what is it going to take to make Georgia more competitive? We asked business leaders around the state. They came back with recommendations. We took the recommendations, and out of that came tax reform. Tax cuts, by the way, folks. For individuals who work and couples that work, we have virtually eliminated the marriage tax penalty on working couples. Wish the federal government could get around to dealing with that issue as well. On the business side of things, we decided that there's no reason whatsoever that Georgia should not once again be a major manufacturing state in the country. What's it going to take to do that? The recommendation was just remove sales tax on energy that is used for manufacturing, because that is an incremental, but a large incremental cost of producing a product. The General Assembly agreed to do that, and we are reaping the benefits every week. In fact, during the first 3 weeks of July, we had already announced 1,400 new jobs for the first 3 weeks. The number of 250,000 new jobs in 3.5 years is growing every day and every week. And as was just mentioned, we had Fiserv here in your area just the other day, It will ultimately be 2,500 jobs there. Just the week before, we were down in Meriwether County with an announcement of a facility there of 1,000 jobs. Those are the kinds of things that are happening across our state. And at the small business level, there are even more cumulatively being announced in your community and communities all across the state. That's why we have not just said we were going to be number one, we've proven it, and we put the policies in place, and private enterprise and families and individuals have responded accordingly. And I am very proud of that. Now, enough of the rhetoric, although that's results, and there is a big difference, by the way, folks. I have every reason to believe we're going to continue to hear a lot of rhetoric on the other side. I believe you can counterbalance rhetoric with results, because that's what counts, that's what people want to see. But let me tell you why your being here is so important. This is an election year in which especially David and I are going to see a lot of state of out-of-state money coming into the races against us. It is from parts of the country that are traditional Democrat strongholds, and they're calling on all of those old ties. I somewhat facetiously have said that my opponent has an advantage over me because he can raise a whole lot more money in his hometown of Chicago, Illinois, than I can raise in Sandersville, Georgia.
There you go. There you go.
But my folks are helping out there. I'm a native Georgian.
Yeah.
I was born in this state in South Georgia. I grew up in Middle Georgia, the son of two dedicated public school teachers who have a cumulative total of 27 years of teaching in the public schools of this state. I married a public school teacher, who herself is a retired middle school teacher. That is my background. I got my education, my college degree, my law degree, all within the state of Georgia. I got my commission to be an officer in the United States Army through ROTC at Mercer University in Georgia. The only time, quite frankly, folks, that Sandra and I have lived outside of the state of Georgia is when the United States Army sent us somewhere else. And thankfully, they saw fit to return us back to Fort Gordon in Augusta, Georgia, where we served for a good part of our military tour. We are Georgians. David is a Georgian. We have a heritage of being the sons of public school teachers growing up in Middle Georgia. That is our heritage. Slick political ads that try to claim legacies of generational Georgianship are not going to fool people. My relatives came here on the third boatload of Salzburgers with General Oglethorpe in 1736. We've been here since. But what you do from here on out until the November election is important. I know you're going to vote Republican, but your outreach to others is really important. There are a lot of people who don't know the success story that our state has had. And unfortunately, sometimes in this media market, we have a great deal of difficulty getting our message out. We generally have to pay to get our message out. But you can be our voices. You can be the ones to cite the examples of why conservative principles of government work. And you can reach those individuals who probably don't pay much attention to political processes or elections. I hope you will reach out to get their attention, to tell them this is an important election. Those of us at the constitutional officer level, we rode that bus back in 2010, when for the first time ever, we elected all constitutional officers in the state of Georgia being Republican. I don't want you to forget those down ballot races, as was mentioned earlier. It's important for us to vote for them as well. They are doing their part of being a part of our team. And to working together, we have moved this state forward. I want to tell you, I get calls and my office gets calls from all over the country. And they're asking questions. How is it that Georgia is doing all of these things right? We want to duplicate what you're doing in our state. That's where I am proud, because that means we are doing things right and other folks are paying attention. They will continue to pay attention. And I agree, our next big challenge is to deal with K through 12 education. This year, we were able to put more money into that part of our budget than we had been able to do in 7 years. And yet my opponent, who had voted for the three previous budgets I'd submitted that did not have nearly that much money in them for education, he voted against it. Of course, he had decided to run for governor before he voted against it. That's a little bit hard to explain, quite honestly, folks. We do have some work to do in K through 12, but if we concentrate on the things that matter, teaching children to read by the time they're leaving the third grade, doing the kind of things that really make a difference in educational outcomes, we can improve that. I'll close with two things that I was told the first day or so that I was in office, and thank you for allowing me to serve in this office. The first thing they told me was, Governor, you know that rainy day fund that everybody talks about that we can call on when bad things happen in the economy to help support our state? We've only got enough money in it now to run state government for 2 days. Well, that doesn't give you a whole lot of comfort. On that story, because we have had conservative budgeting by the members of the General Assembly, and we put that extra money, most of it into our rainy day fund, we have added over $700 million to the rainy day fund. And that's something we're really proud of. The other thing they told me that scared me was, Governor, you know that HOPE program that we all brag so much about? If you don't do something, it's going to go bankrupt in 2013. Now remember, this is in January of 2011. And we can't live up to the promises we've made to young people about providing them with the scholarships. So thanks again to the hard work of the General Assembly. And they had to take hard votes to do this, by the way, folks. We reformed the HOPE program. It is now one of the most fiscally solid programs for providing educational opportunity past high school that any state in the country has. In fact, and as you may know, it is funded exclusively by our lottery program. We just had a report as we have now moved into the 21st year of the lottery supporting the HOPE program. This past year, we had a record high amount of money from the lottery devoted to education, some $945 million. We're going to reach $1 billion in the not too distant future, and that's my goal for next year. So we're doing things right. We're taking good ideas and we're translating them into good results. That's the message that we want you to help us deliver, and I feel sure you will do that. It's now my pleasure to introduce to you someone who's going to be my companion in this election cycle. I thank you for not putting me through what he had to go through with a runoff, but he is our nominee. He is going to be an individual that I think will be an outstanding candidate. I've enjoyed the opportunity of getting to know him a little better. Please welcome our nominee for United States Senate, David Perdue.
They set this up that I would have to follow the governor, and that's not normally done, y'all, so bear with me. You know, it's nice to be from a state that is the number one place in the United States to do business, and I'm delighted to live in Georgia where we have a balanced budget law, we have a governor that's jobs-focused, and a legislature that gets things done, okay? Sound like something we could use in Washington?
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
I want to introduce my wife, Bonnie. This is Bonnie. A little damp. I'm sorry. We have already sweated through this shirt already. We just walked 2 miles in the old soldiers parade over in Alpharetta. So it was all good, and I'm delighted to be here. But y'all, we have a dog fight on our hands. We just survived a long dog fight among ourselves. This intramural fight we just had was not fun. And Jack and I have kissed and made up, and we met in Washington this week. We've talked several times. And he and I both have said in the primary that one thing's important. One thing is true. This is bigger than me. It's bigger than Jack. This is too important to let individual emotions or opinions or whatever get in the way. We have got to stop Harry Reid from getting one more vote in the United States Senate. And I want a round of applause for a young man here, Dominic over here, that's holding the fort for us this morning. Dominic, thank you. I just have a couple of quick things to say to you guys. God bless you for working like you do for our party, for working for Georgia. And I say that to Jack people, to my people, to anybody that's active in our political system. This is what we have got to do to win this election this fall, not only for the governor and all the other races we have, but for our race as well. And thank God you're here, and we're going to win this because of you. I have two things to say. One, we will not take our opponent lightly. I respect her. I respect her work. I respect her family. She's just on the wrong team, y'all. Listen, this is a clear choice. If you like what's going on in Washington, you've got to vote for her because you know she's going to saddle up with Harry Reid, Nancy Pelosi, and God help us, Barack Obama. And we cannot have that in the state of Georgia. Their values are not our values. The governor's right. I grew up right here in Middle Georgia. Bonnie and I met in first grade. And this accent is real, and so are my values. And I have been around the world. We have not lost either. And I'm not going to Washington to drink the Kool-Aid. We have got to make change in Washington. Imagine what we could do in this state if we could get all the nonsense from Washington to stop holding us back. Right, Governor? I mean, we could do so many great things. But the governor's already called it out. To beat Michelle Nunn, we've got to beat the national Democratic machine. For Governor Deal to win, we've got to beat the national Democratic machine. If you don't believe me, read their plan. It's out there. And we're not going to let that happen. I am very humbled to be here as your nominee. I'm humbled to be on this docket with all these great men and women. And you have my pledge and Bonnie's pledge. We will not leave any stone unturned to win this thing. Because if you're as outraged as I am by the size and scope of this government, by the nonsense we read in the press every day, by the fact and the excuses they won't secure our borders, the amount of debt they're piling up on the backs of our kids and grandkids, then I ask three things of you today. One is trust me. I have your best interest and my best interest. More important, I have the best interest of our kids and grandkids is the first thing I think about every morning when I get up to do this. The second thing is stand with me. And I heard a man explain what that meant. I've been saying that for a few weeks, and I need you to stand with us because I can't do this. The governor can't do it. Gary can't do it. We can all do it together, but you know, in the past, we've been fighting each other so much that we have forgot who the real enemy is. And we can't do that right now and beat them this year. They're gonna pile so much money in here, it's not funny. But I need you to stand with me, and that means not get behind the governor, not get behind me. Get beside us. That's what these other men and women are doing. Get beside us, just like we did in the Revolutionary War. And when you do that, you look straight ahead. And your responsibility is your church, your family, your neighborhood, your friends, your relatives. Win them, and we'll do fine. Listen, there's one reason I'm doing this. And if you're as outraged as I am by all that, then I ask you to do the third thing. And it is, help me take our country back. And I mean that. Help me take our country back. They tell me I don't smile enough, but I'm working on that. But this is dead serious. If you ever want to change America and get our country back, that's not a slogan. I didn't pay some Madison Avenue guy to do that. That came up in the middle of one night because we just started having grandkids. And I don't like the world that I'm leaving them. And you don't either. And we can do it right now in this race, right here in Georgia. And not only that, we can set the tone and the mood to take back the United States Senate right here in Georgia. And we're going to do it starting right here in this race. I'm going to turn it back over to John, I think, right? But I want to tell you, the Republican Party has been so good in the last couple weeks, in the last year, mobilizing. You know all the details. You guys up here are working hard. And I am so gracious, and I'm so glad to be a part of this team. And you have my word that we're going to do everything we can to make you proud, to make your trust worthwhile. And I want you to hold me responsible because we're going to win this in the fall and not let Harry Reid have one more seat in the United States Senate. Thank you very much.
Two guys running at the top of the ticket that actually understand something about producing jobs. Yep. I just think it's extraordinarily special for the state of Georgia, and I thank them both for everything that they do and are going to do. We're very fortunate.